Humanity Works Better, 5 Practices to Lead with Awareness, Choice, and the Courage to Change. Written and narrated by Kate Roeske-Zummer and Debbie Cohen. I'm Kate Roeske-Zummer.
I'm Debbie Cohen, one of the authors of Humanity Works Better, and along with Kate, we'll be trading off the reading of each chapter. At the end, we'll list resources for those interested in learning more about Humanity Works and how we help organizations improve workplace productivity. Introduction. Imagine what it feels like to work in a place that treats people like human beings, not resources. Imagine what's possible when how you work together is just as important as what work you do. Imagine working in an organization where people and profits are equally valued. This is a place where humanity works, and this is what we want for you and the people you work with. Humanity Works Better was written to help you and your organizations improve workplace productivity. Working together is messy, and most people don't know how to navigate it well. This results in behaviors that create toxicity and roadblocks that stall productivity. Yet, when working together is deeper and more connected, people give more of themselves and business wins. You can tell if humanity is at work by looking at the quality and depth of workplace relationships. We realized the significance of this in 2005 when working with a large Silicon Valley tech company. We were working with a team of 30 directors and their boss. The team wanted to work more effectively as a group. At the end of our first day together, we led an evening exercise on vulnerability, modified from Patrick Lencioni's great work, Getting Naked. Each person was asked to come prepared to talk about a personal quality that was both a positive and a negative, and to share something that was going on in their lives that the rest of their group might not know about. The exercise asked participants to be vulnerable, which typically isn't common or easy in a workplace environment. There were these two guys, both brilliant engineers, close in age, and from a similar cultural background. It was evident from their interactions that they were each other's nemesis as well as each other's biggest fans. These two men had spent long nights together trying to solve some of the biggest technology challenges facing the organization. At times, even staying overnight and sleeping under their desks to deliver on product deadline. One of them, we'll call him Jonah, started his story by describing his background, his marriage, and the birth of his beloved daughter. He and his wife began noticing their daughter, who was 4 years old, had a cold that just wouldn't go away. As he was talking, the room got quieter and quieter. His colleague, we'll call him Nick, leaned in a little closer. Jonah shared how he and his wife had taken their little girl to a multitude of doctors and specialists. The long and the short of it was their little girl had been diagnosed with leukemia. They didn't know what the outcome would be. And that's where his story ended for that evening. As he concluded, you could have heard a pin drop in the room. When someone is sharing their story, we ask others to stay silent, not to ask questions, interrupt, or crosstalk. The role of the listener is to be present with that person, to witness them and the story they are telling. Soon, it was time for a break. Nick approached Jonah and hugged him, saying, "I had no idea you were dealing with this. I'm so sorry." And the two left the room, deep in conversation. At that moment, the purpose of Humanity Works, our coaching, consulting, and training organization, crystallized. We saw it so clearly. Something is terribly wrong with our work relationships if people are literally sleeping on the floor next to their colleagues and have no idea what's happening for them as human beings. Everyone in that room was impacted by genuinely witnessing one another. They began to see their coworkers as more complex human beings. They were more aware that when they share the more vulnerable sides of their lives, a deeper human connection is created, that each of them leads rich, full, complex lives of which work is just one part. We are on a mission to bring more humanity to the workplace and to you as a leader, so we can change the world of work together. This fundamental goal is what drove us to create Humanity Works, and it's what underpins the research, stories, and practices we offer you in this book. At Humanity Works, we focus on traits that help people demonstrate the qualities of being a good human. We think one of the core ways of being a good human and a good leader is by caring about the people around you. This creates a connection that not only makes working together more fulfilling, but also paves the way to doing great things. Think about it. The backbone of any good relationship is that you know that a person cares about you. This knowledge is the lens through which you evaluate everything a person says and does, be it positive or negative. If you know in your heart that someone cares about you, then you trust what they say, and that can motivate you to act. If you don't think they care about you, then you can get triggered and react negatively to any action or word that they utter. This begins a downward spiral in any relationship. It boosts up that assumption-making machine within you. You start to invent stories about why they said what they said. You begin to pull back or defend yourself. You find yourself some allies and you build your case against your nemesis. You resist working with that person. You are officially triggered. Trust is gone and a productive working relationship is out the window. At the heart of the Humanity Works movement and this book is you. If things are not quite right in your workplace, the real change starts with you. Being a leader in its fullest expression is about continuity of character. That's what makes people want to work with you, to follow you, and it helps you get stuff done. If you want to be a better leader, start with awareness. How are you being with others? How do you choose to show up? How does that affect those around you? Being a leader is about having the courage to let go of what's not serving you and stepping into a more impactful way of leading. As a leader, you have tremendous influence on the people in your organization. People deserve a workplace where they are valued as humans, not resources. And when humanity works better, the workplace thrives. This book will guide your journey to become aware of who you want to be and choosing how to live the whole of your life, inside and outside the workplace, to be consistent with those beliefs. It lays out the case for why more humanity is needed at work today. But it goes beyond the why. It's also a how-to book. It provides skills and tools to help you navigate the complex relationships that make us human beings. Complexities that often become the roadblocks that make it hard to get important work done. In part one, we look at productivity and mindset. According to 21st Century Skills, which provides students with the essential skills, knowledge, and expertise needed to be successful throughout their life, productivity is the ability to create a product by setting and meeting goals, prioritizing needs, managing time, working ethically, collaborating, and cooperating with colleagues and clients. Goals, prioritization, and time management are tried and true methods to achieve productivity outcomes like alignment and accountability. The softer skills of working ethically, collaboration, and cooperation reflect the growing importance of how we work together. These drive essential productivity outcomes like trust, resiliency, and engagement. A big roadblock to embracing the softer skills can be how you think about things, your mindset. Your mindset is a reflection of your attitudes and beliefs, which influence your behaviors. It takes attention and awareness to shift mindsets that hold you back from being the person you want to be. In part two, we take a deep dive into the five fundamental practices that teach leaders and the people in their organizations exactly how to build the muscle required to work together productively as human beings. These practices offer insight into your behaviors and the practical skills and tools for action. We show you how creating safety builds trust. Working together manifests resilience. Claiming values produces alignment. Owning your impact drives accountability. And daring not to know creates engagement. These five practices put people first. They are how you deepen connection with the people around you so you can be more productive. They are the magic for success and drive unrealized business results. This book will help you produce these outcomes. Good humans, doing good work, increasing productivity and organizational strength. Humanity works better. This book has the potential to change you, and it will make you more aware of yourself. It will challenge you to try new skills and ways of thinking about yourself and those around you. It will ignite a desire to change things about yourself, things that are holding you back from being the kind of human you want to be. Change is courageous and hard work, so be gentle with yourself. You are unlearning, unlocking yourself, and building new muscle. You will have good days and bad days. You will have exciting moments when you're conscious of your competence and you're doing it. It's working. And you'll have harder days when it just does not work. So be patient. Change takes time, and practice, practice, practice. Kate will now read chapter 1. Productivity, it's all about people.
Chapter 1. Productivity, it's all about people. A great deal of business focus in the 1990s and early 2000s was on efficiency. Cut the fat, work lean. This created solid business results. Michael Mankin, in his article, Great Companies Obsess Over Productivity, Not Efficiency, wrote, earnings growth for the S&P 500 ran at nearly three times the rate of inflation over this period, despite tepid top-line growth in many years. In effect, companies reduced the cost of doing business and found financial gains. Around 2015, this strategy stopped working. Mankin writes, without top-line growth, continuing to wring out greater profits through efficiency has become the managerial equivalent of attempting to squeeze blood from a stone. So business pivoted from a focus on efficiency to a focus on productivity. If efficiency is about less is more, productivity is about doing more with the same. Productivity is the rate of output per unit of input. The concept harkens back to a time when people worked on a factory line and their value is measured by the time it took to produce a single item. Envision being a factory line worker where the speed of the conveyor belt is turned up and you are expected to turn up your output accordingly. Those who could not keep up were replaced. While humans may not have benefited, this approach served business well during the manufacturing and mass production era. In today's knowledge-based economy, productivity faces at least two challenges the earlier era did not. One, a shortage of talent, and two, the increasing awareness that the intellectual capital of talent walks out the door when they leave at the end of each day or when they quit for good. In March 2019, pre-pandemic, Vox reported a widespread worker shortage in the United States. In the decades leading up to 2020, there had been more available workers than available jobs. However, by the end of January 2020, things were beginning to shift. The U.S. economy had 7.6 million unfilled jobs, but only 6.5 million people were looking for work, according to the U.S. Department of Labor. This was the 11th straight month that the number of job openings was higher than the number of job seekers. Each month, the gap grew. Recovery from the historic unemployment rates experienced during the pandemic will slow the effect of the labor shortage for a while, but the reality of the shortage remains and is looming. There are just too few people for too many jobs. With baby boomers retiring en masse and a replacement workforce in short supply, it is no longer a viable approach to productivity to simply demand that fewer people produce.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.